the awareness of the Holy Spirit has seemed to be cranked up to a new level in my own home life. And I know it's one of the reasons I'd asked Miss Polly to pray over me this morning, and she did, with the banner of the Holy Spirit and just praying over me. And one of the reasons I really wanted her to is she's experiencing just a really fresh move of the Holy Spirit in her life right now. And literally what we want to do, I want to fan that. Just get it, heat it up, get you red hot, I tell you. So what I want to do, the Holy Spirit's given me some special instructions with this word, and I want to follow him. But one thing I want to ask you, let's just think a minute. Why is the Holy Spirit so vital, so important to us at all times, but right now? You know, see, one of the things I think if we're going to really experience revival, it can only happen with a move of the Holy Spirit, with him being free. So one of the things that has to happen is you have to get him out. We can't put him in a box. Let me ask you, he's described in John 3 as the wind. Can you put the wind in a box? It'll go in, but it's going to come right back out. It can't be contained in any sort of, you can't control the wind. You can rely upon it. You can move with the wind, but you don't put your hand up to stop it. It just blows right through your hand. The Holy Spirit is so vital for us today. I think at times we have treated him with a degree of disrespect. I mean, I've heard people say things like, speaking in tongues is just foolish gibberish. But wait a minute. If that originates from the Holy Spirit himself, how can we treat it as if it was something silly? Because he doesn't do anything silly. He does everything on time, on purpose, and with an intent of releasing. But there's more to it than that. You see, he is the part of the Trinity that is here on earth. He is here. He fully represents Father's heart. He fully represents the mind of Christ. He brings his role is literally this: to bring forth in our lives everything that Father has intended for man from the beginning when he created Adam. And he is here to bring forth everything that Jesus obtained, got for us when he went to the cross, to the grave, and was resurrected and is now at the right hand of God. Everything Jesus did, the Holy Spirit is here to bring that forth. So we have to honor everything he does. And see, there are times, how many of y'all know this? He will take you to a place that you don't understand. Or he'll have you do things maybe you don't understand. But see, I'm going to get ahead of myself. I'll talk about praying in tongues or praying in the Spirit in a little bit. But you see, that in itself, he wants to take us beyond our minds. He wants to take us to the place that we are trusting him. In fact, one of the things that I do often, I'll find myself praying in the Spirit. And after a period of time, my intellect doesn't have a clue. But what I love to do is at the end I say, amen. I agree with everything I just said. And that's bore not on my understanding, but on my trust of the Holy Spirit. That I want whatever He's praying, I want that to come forth in my life. One other thing I'm going to say to you. Now, we've been on this journey for some time. We started this entire revelation all on the kingdom of God. That's where it was birthed, studying the kingdom of God. And it has taken us to places I never dreamed. We got into gates and doors. We got into some marvelous insights. And the greatest gate of all is the gate of God's love. I mean, and then His goodness. And we've been talking about all of the aspects of the kingdom of God. Okay, how many of y'all can quote the scripture, Romans 14, 17? I want you to memorize it. It's a vital scripture for us today. Romans 14, 17. You'll know it. The kingdom of God is not meat or drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Amen? It is. This is in the Tree of Life version. For the kingdom of God is not about eating and drinking. It's righteousness, shalom, or peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So I want you to memorize that, because everything we've been teaching you for the last 2 years, every aspect of it, every dimension of it, everything of it operates by the Holy Spirit. Everything. There's not anything in the kingdom of God that doesn't operate by the Holy Spirit. So there are times, let me just say, because I was hearing this in my spirit, we were reading or singing songs this morning, about taking my fear. And I was thinking about it. The source of fear, anxiety, and worry is you taking the responsibility of something you were not expected to carry. If you were totally trusting the Holy Spirit and the wind of the Spirit, or the river, it talks about it in Ezekiel, about the river of God, and He wants us to jump because He wants us to swim. Because when you're swimming, especially if you're in a flow like a river, it will carry you. You don't even have to put out a lot of effort. It will just carry you downstream. And that's what He wants us to do. He wants us to get into this place of totally trusting the Holy Spirit with our lives. I've got a lot of notes. Because the way... My whole way of coming up with sermons changed 2 years ago. Or 2.5 years ago. Right or wrong, it's just the way it's been. I don't go back in my old notes. It's like there's something He's showing me fresh, and I'm just going with it. I don't know what to do with it other than just share with you what He's showing me. So how I get a sermon is for 3, 4, 5 weeks, I'm writing notes everywhere. He'll download them. I will write this down. So the week of the sermon gets kind of, in fact, one of the reasons that I did it this time, I typed it, not because I like to type, but because I had so many notes, I couldn't get them in the right order. And I didn't want to keep rewriting it. So when you do it on the computer, you can just insert it. And so these are some of the notes. With the idea of Romans 14, 17, the kingdom does not operate by rules. We operate by rules. Man likes rules. He likes control. And see, this is the key. This is the, as Pastor Daniel said, this is where the rubber meets the road. It's about control. Who's in control? And sometimes when you've really planned hard and you've given, weeks of preparation, and in the last second the Holy Spirit shifts and you have to lay down all of that preparation to go with the Holy Spirit, it's sometimes hard to do that. It really is. but you have to say, I would rather go your way than to go my way of all the preparation that I put into it. I still would rather go your way, because without the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, we can do nothing more than just make plans, fill notebooks with notes, and just have all of this information, but we're not changing anything. In fact, this has been one of the things that has been a heart cry of mine. I've been sharing it with some of my pastor friends lately. We had a new pastor in our group this last week, and his name was Jeff. And he's starting a church called Influence Church. And I said, Jeff, I love the name. Because I said, what I see happening in the church, we have the ability to grow churches to be 30, 40, 50,000 in numbers and still have no influence. I said, that breaks my heart. I mean, it's like we're putting all of our effort in to creating something that's not changing lives. Y'all understand what I just mean by that? I'm not being critical. I'm just saying, God, there's got to be a better way. And he said, hello, I'm the better way. If you will allow me, because one thing he told me, he said, you can do church without the Holy Spirit, but you can't do the kingdom of God. Isn't that a true statement? You can do church. Because you can't bring the kingdom dominion into the earth without the one Father sent to empower us, to enable us to do that very thing. We can't do it without him. And unfortunately, we've learned to grow churches that have more of the form but lack the power. And I think what God's looking for today, and because see, I think this is why he is dropping such revelation into this congregation, is because your heart, aren't you ready to say yes to the Holy Spirit? I mean, every one of you, you're ready. God, whatever you want to do, we want to move with you. Because building his kingdom, it can't be achieved by developing a plan. It must be by the Holy Spirit. And we cannot ever try to regulate. This is so important because this has been done so much. We cannot regulate his manifestations.
Yes.
We cannot. We cannot come to a conclusion, such a conclusion about all the events surrounding Pentecost that we put him under this control and say, okay, so therefore this is the only way we permit you to move. No. What if what he did on the day of Pentecost will never occur again? What if what he designs to do today is greater than what he did on the day of Pentecost? Can we just trust him and allow him to do? Because, see, one of the things that happens when we create doctrinal controls over what we want to see happen in an effort to keep down error. Nobody wants error. Okay, I understand that. But the very thing that keeps you from error also keeps you from the breakthrough. Because now all of a sudden, when he wants to move in a way that you said we're not going to permit, now you got a problem. Because you either yield to him or you stay within your rules and you don't move with him. Because you see, our calling to them, it's impossible. I'm telling you, what God has put in every one of your hearts, what he has called you to, is absolutely impossible without the Holy Spirit.
Yes. Amen.
It's absolutely impossible without him. So we are being brought to a place of surrender to him, of a new level of honor. You know, we're not going to be ashamed of how the Holy Spirit has moved in our lives. And we're not going to treat it like, well, you know, I guess I must be an oddball. I mean, everybody has labeled people who have moved with the Holy Spirit. I mean, even to the point, my own father was on the, what do they call the guys that get together to go find a pastor. The pastoral search committee.
Oh, yes.
I think is what it is. The pastor search committee. You ever met with those?
Yeah.
Dad was on one, and with this one point. He said, I always ask them to tell me about the Holy Spirit. And if they act too freely, I vote against them. I said, Dad. You see, we don't understand. Who the Holy Spirit is. We say, if my dad would be one that would do this, he absolutely loved Father. Well, how can you love Father and not love Father's Spirit?
Amen.
You know, in 1 Corinthians 2, it talks about the only way you can know a man is to know the spirit of a man.
That's right.
The only way you can know the true heart of Father is to know the spirit of Father. And so if we're on one side, we love, you see, we love people love Father because He's in heaven. And He's not actively in Himself as being the Father. He's not actively moving our lives. So because what He did was He sent His Spirit to do that. It's still Him. The Holy Spirit is still Father. Hello? The Holy Spirit is still Father. Say that. The Holy Spirit is still Father. The Holy Spirit is Jesus. They're one. Can you get the picture when Jesus came into that upper room? And He said, as the Father had sent me, I'm sending you. Wow. And He said to me, breathe on them. And He basically said, receive my Spirit. So what's another word for spirit? Breath. So, when you know that He is the very heart of Father. He's the heart. He is the very essence of God Himself, actively on earth, bringing forth the plans of Father. So how can we ever resist Him? Even Jesus couldn't go into the ministry without being full of the Holy Spirit. Now, okay, let's just stop. Go with me to Luke chapter 4. I've been just reaching, not giving you any scriptures. Go with me to Luke chapter 4. Verse 1. And Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan. So when did Jesus receive the Spirit? Okay. So the Holy Spirit, John described it as the Holy Spirit came upon him as a dove. Now, I don't think he looked like a dove. I think it was the way he saw the very presence of God come upon him. It was like the softness of how a dove would light. But let's just take, for instance, just a second. The Spirit of God coming upon you. I didn't bring it on. And so you came up out of the water, and the Holy Spirit came upon you, and it landed on him, and it says, and it remained. It dwelled there. It took up residence on him. So at that point on, he carried the Holy Spirit. But I just want to say something to you. If you're aware of the presence of the Holy Spirit, it will affect the way you walk. It will affect the way you talk, the way you think. But let's stop. It'll affect the way you walk. Picture with me. A dove is on my shoulder. And I'm going to honor the presence of that dove. I'm not going to do stuff to disturb it, am I? Not if I want it to remain. So all of a sudden my walk has changed. I'm aware. You ever had a pookie? Anybody here ever a parrot? And it would land on you? You know, you always do funny things with grandkids and animals. I don't know why. We actually, but all of a sudden we've got this dove on our shoulder. It changes how we walk. Now the Holy Spirit came and remained on Jesus, and so he was full of the Holy Spirit. When when the Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness. So go to verse 14. Then Jesus returned out of that time, that encounter with the enemy, and it says, and Jesus came in the power of the Spirit. He was now empowered to go into ministry. He now carried with him the fullness of the power. Now you say, but why would Jesus have to go through these steps? Because he's the Son of Man. He's showing us that at salvation, we receive the Holy Spirit, but we've got to be empowered. That's why, we'll get to the book of Acts here in a second. But Jesus, he knew something. He knew we couldn't do it, so he had to walk out how we move into ministry. You can't move unless you have the Holy Spirit not just in you, but on you, because you have to have his power to minister. So go with me to Acts 1. Acts chapter 1, just begin in the verse. The former account I made with Theophilus of all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commands to the apostles whom he had chosen. Notice, now everything Jesus did, he did through the Holy Spirit. And allowing the Holy Spirit to impart, to empower every word that he gave. To whom he also presented himself alive after suffering for many infallible truths, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking the things concerning or pertaining to the kingdom of God. Getting them ready for ministry. Not just to go start a church, build a church, but how to bring the kingdom of God into the earth. I think that's our assignment. That's the assignment of the Holy Spirit. It's the assignment he wants us to embrace. Verse 4, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them, do not leave, do not depart Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he said you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from hence. So, what are we talking about? We're talking about a promise made to us by our Father. Pastor Roy, this is a promise. This is an amazing promise. It is a promise that he wants us to walk in the fullness of the Spirit in a way that we're not just stumbling in the dark, so to speak. I've got a lot more to teach, but I feel prompted in my spirit because he has some testimony. Let me just share something with you. One of the things, the greatest thing that happened on the day of Pentecost was that the Spirit of God came upon them. Before in the upper room, they had received the Spirit. Now he came upon them to empower them for ministry. And one of the things that happened to them was that they began to speak in tongues. And there is no limitation to that. We'll get more into the teaching of this next week. But we do know that there is a public demonstration of tongues that has to be followed with an interpretation, because understanding is important. That's why Paul would say it's greater for you to prophesy or to speak in the known language so that everyone hears. But he said, I want you all to pray in tongues. I pray in tongues more than all of you. We'll get into that. But you see, praying in tongues takes you out of your intellect. Because if all you're doing is praying from your intellect, you're not praying the mysteries of heaven. You're not praying what heaven wants released. And the Holy Spirit, because of the way God established earth and giving the authority that he did to us as his representative on earth, that the Holy Spirit can easily go and say and relieve, but He needs our voices. Even the prophetic side, God said, I don't do anything unless I first tell it to my prophets so that it is announced. I want everything announced. I want everything to come through you. You're the one that is to release this. So we carry a great authority with this empowering of the Holy Spirit that we receive when we are baptized into and by the Holy Spirit. It's vitally important if we want to do anything in the realm of ministry at any level, touching people's lives. We need this empowering in our lives. I have. But I want to talk to you some personal testimonies. Now, this last week, my wife and I were visiting with a couple of ladies in our neighborhood. While we were talking, an ambulance with the siren going went by. Then a fire chief went by. Then a police went by. And then a fire truck goes by. Well, one of the ladies looks out and said, wow, they're just stopping half a block down the street. So I go out and I look in. I'm looking into the trees in front of the house, and smoke is coming out through all those trees. And so I go up there, and there's now one pumping truck there, and they're by themselves, and there's a couple of firemen. It's a volunteer fire department out in the country, or out in the county, and waiting for the others to come. And I'm watching them as they're trying to get all their hoses and get their gear on and get ready to go into the house, and smoke is just billowing out of the attic. And I'm just praying protection, and all of a sudden, something that I've learned to recognize, because I'm not a person that cries. I mean, we can watch a movie, and my wife will cry frequently. And I'll turn and I'll say, you know, this is just a movie. I mean, do you ladies understand?
No, don't get it.
I've only cried at one movie in my life.
Bambi.
And that movie had a prophetic thing that hit me. But I'm watching this house, all of a sudden I begin to weep. It's okay, God. You're doing something. So I just began to pray in tongues. And I'm getting into it. And I'm not quiet. And I'm just right across the street from it. And I'm just praying. And I don't know what I'm praying. I pray for about 10 minutes. There's other firemen. They start to arrive and they're trying to unfold their hoses. And this whole process seemed to be going a lot slower than it needed to be, you know. But I never got into any of that. I just said, okay, God, you placed me here on purpose. And so I'm just going to pray in the Spirit. And in the midst of praying, and as the firemen are starting to get into the house, the smoke stops. I don't know what is going on the inside. And the firemen are getting in there. They're going in, and they're coming out with their mask off. And all of a sudden, all that burden just lifts. And I said, thank you, Lord. I just thank you that I believe it was all a divine appointment. I need to be there. It reminded me of another time. This one is the most amazing experience. Probably ranks up there just... I still think about it, and I'm just totally amazed at what God did. I was helping a friend move his office, and I was driving the U-Haul truck heading to his office. And this is in Fort Worth, and we're on the freeway. And it's one of those freeways where I think it's like six lanes wide. You know, it's a big one. And there's a, I'm coming up on an entrance from the service room, and here comes this motorcycle. Oh, man, flying. Probably well in excess of 100 miles an hour. And then right behind it was a motorcycle policeman in hot pursuit. And I'm watching, and the motor, there is a Suburban in the far right-hand lane, and the motorcyclist, the one that's running from the police, goes in front of him. Well, it looked like the policeman had an indecision whether to go in front or go around. Well, he decided to go around, but he didn't time it because of his speed. And I later learned he was probably doing like 120 at the time. And he hits the back of this SUV, or Suburban, and flies up into the air. I mean, I don't know. Seemed like 20, 30 feet in the air. I mean, with that impact and the force, Mike, you can probably relate to, you know, what you can kind of see the scenario here. And he's flying in the air, comes down face first onto the concrete. And I'm saying no, 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 and I stopped the, I pull over with the U-Haul and stop, get out, and I run to him, and he's trying to move, and I said, sir, stay still. Now, just picture this. Let's say he's laying right here. His head's right here. And so I'm at his head, and I'm just trying to calm him. Well, instantly a lady comes and says, I'm a nurse. And I said, great. And another guy comes, he says, I'm an EMT. I said, great. So they're ministering, they're keeping him straight and helping him to stay calm. So I stand up, and again, I start praying in tongues. For the next several minutes, 20, 30 minutes, I don't know all the time, I can't tell you the time. Now, dozens of emergency vehicles are coming. There's several police, several firemen, several EMT people with the ambulances. A helicopter comes and lands, and they're going to transfer him. I mean, all of this is going on, but I'm standing right at his head, praying in tongues. No one asked me to move. It was as if they recognized I had authority and I was accomplishing something they couldn't, they didn't dare touch. Man. I'm just telling you to understanding the importance of what I'm talking about. Had I didn't believe, those were telling me, if you've been praying in English, they would have asked you to move. Because you would have been praying only in your own intellect. You'd have been praying only more out of your own realm of understanding and authority. But I allowed the Holy Spirit to move through me. Now, let me tell you a couple of amazing things that happened. Number one, he was alert when they put him into the helicopter. And I heard later that he joked with them all the way, never went into shock. Now, he was covered in blood, which you can imagine. Except when they get to the hospital, he had a couple of broken bones in his body, like his wrist, I think were broken where he must have hit hard. And he broke his nose. They said that was the source of the blood, the broken nose. He left the hospital in 3 days. He was in church the following week. The man is a believer. He actually, he wanted me to go and to come and maybe we could do a duet together. And I said, let me tell you something. I am so thrilled with that. I don't want, it wasn't me. I didn't do. That was the Holy Spirit. You go, you ask the Holy Spirit to sing with you. You go, but so I was, I met him 3 days in the hospital right before he was dismissed. And now get this. The next week, I receive a letter the police chief, thanking me for what I did.
Wow.
Now, you understand, all I did was stand there praying in tongues. So even the police chief recognized, because I didn't know it, he had also arrived on the scene, saw what was taking place, saw what was being happened, and he said, when I got the results of what happened to that man, I knew what you were doing turned everything for you. He said, honestly, from what you described, he should not have survived. Would you believe that, Mike?
Yeah.
And to have minor injuries, technically minor injuries, and to walk out of the hospital and throw 3 days later. I mean, had there not been someone, anyone, that knew how to enter into that realm of praying with the authority of the Holy Spirit, he may not have survived. So I'm just saying that to you because the Holy Spirit wants me to make a point to you. This is vital. This is not just something that we play with. It is not something, I mean, on any given Sunday morning, I spend more time. See, Paul says, I sing in the Spirit, I sing in my understanding. I pray in the Spirit, and I pray in my understanding. I spend as much time worshiping over here in tongues, whether singing in tongues or praying in tongues, than I do in English. And I do it because I want the Holy Spirit's authority to get released in me. I'm not doing it just. And I find, I find myself doing it more and more and more. But I don't do it as a, I'm not putting on a show. I mean, most of y'all wouldn't even know I did that. I'm just sharing it with you that I do that. Because it's not a matter of show, it's a matter of taking the power of the Holy Spirit and releasing it into a situation. We need to be doing this more. Isn't that amazing? Now, I want you to do something. I want you just to give God some praise, but not nothing coming to me, because I didn't. All I did was stand there. I couldn't even tell you why I prayed. I'm just, one, just allowing the Holy Spirit to flow through me. And he did the supernatural. See, this is what Jesus said. If you don't believe me, then believe the very works, because I don't do the works. It's Father that does the works. It is the Holy Spirit that is working through us to bring about whatever takes place. We can't take the credit. We just give God the glory. In fact, I love one pastor who said, when anybody comes and says, oh my, thank you for what you did, maybe the word, the prayer, you just turned my life around, and I just thank you so much. Well, God bless you. Thank you for sharing that. And he goes over, he says, God, I just got praise. I want to give that to you. Doesn't belong to me. I'm not going to hold on to it more than 2 or 3 minutes. As quick as I can, I'm going to let go of it. Because it's not about me, it's about you. So one thing he's calling us to is getting comfortable go with me to 1 Corinthians 14 just for a second. I want to share. Then I got another testimony to show you. 1 Corinthians 14:1. It says, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. But he says, desire, it literally means to give high honor to the gifts of the Spirit. It means to have such a longing in your heart for the Holy Spirit to have freedom to move through you. It is a part of our pursuing love. It's an extension of both his love in our hearts and our love for him that we would want to see the very gifts, because when you're in a situation, if all you're depending on is what's between these 2 years, it's limited what you're going to be able to do. Actually, very limited. But you can do some things. Man has been doing things with just what we see for years, and we've survived. But see, if we would earnestly have a tender heart, have this warm compassion in our heart for the things of the Holy Spirit, I want you to understand how much He wants you. How much He loves you. Now, many of you may have had a similar story as mine. The Holy Spirit has prompted me several times this week. I got just enough time to do it, to share with you my story of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Because it's not normal. I was a music director at Marshall Baptist Church. Now, they didn't approve of such things. We had a family. I don't know if anybody in here ever met Dale and Jerry Heslop. Anybody ever met Dale and Jerry Heslop? I don't know. Dale had an air conditioning business. And if you were to look up wild, fanatic, charismatics, their picture would be there. They literally chased me around the parking lot every Sunday trying to lay hands on me. And I ran as fast as I could. I even had one time, they were wanting to take me to a Charles and Francis Hunter meeting. Ever seen? I mean, which is pretty extreme. I mean, they're not mainstream anything. They're way out there. Fun people. And so I said, well, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to test the spirits. I'm going to go. I'm going to find out. So this was at a time, this was a number of years ago, and my first wife, Carolyn, and I, and Dale and Jerry, and it's normal, and it seems to be, we go late. But I think that was the Holy Spirit, because we went late, big crowd, and we were, extra chairs set up in the back of the auditorium. So here I am, I'm here, I'm going to see if there's really a miracle takes place. And where am I? I can't even see Charles and Francis Hunter. I don't see hardly anything. And so the ministry begins, and Francis stands and said, if you've got back trouble, stand up. Well, Carolyn had always had lower back pain. I mean, severe lower back pain. Always caused her problems. I mean, severe back pain. Well, obedient as we were as Baptists, she stood up. And all of a sudden, she realized what she was doing. She sat back down. So I leave the meeting thinking, I didn't see anything. This isn't of God. So the next morning, Carolyn says, remember last night? You remember when they said anybody with back trouble stand? I said, yeah. And you stood. She said, I did. I immediately sat right back down because I looked out of place. I shouldn't have done that. But immediately I had this extreme warmth and heat came into my back. I said, Monty, you know that miracle you were wanting to see? Hello? How close can we be to see this miracle? So you would have thought, oh, okay, well, I would just yield. No, I'm a good runner. And I was faithful to my running. I was, I'd been warned, and I'm running as fast as I could. And so I get this phone call from my dad in Linnaeus, Missouri. And this is close to the Iowa border. And two of the deacons in the church, Mr. Rushton and my dad, each had sons in the ministry. Stan Rushton was a Southern Baptist evangelist, and I was a music director for a Southern Baptist church. So they thought, perfect, we'll bring our two sons in to run our annual tent revival across the street in the park. So I'm thinking, now as a good runner, I'm thinking, look, I know the Holy Spirit has never been to Linnaeus. I'm safe there. It's a good place just to get away from all of this craziness and get up there where they don't ever even mention the Holy Spirit. I mean, they haven't. I mean, So I'm thinking this is the same place. So I get up to Galenius, Missouri, run the park under the tent. Everything's just going great. I mean, I love Stan. Stan and I connect just real quick. And he was a fun-loving guy. And we kind of joked and laughed. We're ready for the sermon. So, you know, we do the music. And then I'm on the platform behind him. And he begins to preach a sermon on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I mean, you could have just seen me. I'm like, now I start laughing. I said, this is ridiculous. Okay, I surrender. The run is over. I give in. You got me. I didn't know what else I'd do next. So I think it's time just to give in. Okay, so I left after the service, but Stan's family had a big reception. They had a lot of relatives in the area. They were all there and had this big reception. And so I couldn't get to Stan. Stan had brought a little travel trailer with him, and he always took it to his revival so he had a place to get alone. And so he had this travel trailer behind the tent. And he was there early in the morning, and I'm knocking on the door, and he opens it, and I said, "Hey, Stan, I want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit." He said, "Shh, shh." Okay, I'm still just locked in and receiving. I wasn't understanding what was taking place. So he asked me to come in, closes the door behind us. "How did you know?" Yes, 1975. A few years ago. How old are you? Ask me how old you are. That's what? 25, 43 years ago. Wow, long time. And so he ushers me in, and he said, "Bonnie, I just received a week ago myself." Still, most of this is going over my head at this point in time. And I said, "I want you to pray for me. I've never prayed for anybody." I said, "Pray for me. I don't want to receive it." So he prays for me. Well, from every extremity, from my feet, my hands, my head, it's like a numbness just starts rushing into the middle. And I didn't fall. I melted. I just literally melted into the floor of that little travel trailer. And I was down there for the longest, to the point that Stan was about to go get medical help. He thought he'd kill me. He never prayed for anybody before. He didn't have that happen to him. He didn't know what was going on. And all he knew is I wasn't moving. And just about the time he's about to panic and run, I start stirring. And I'm drunk. I mean, I'm so drunk. Now, I'll tell you, I can tell you the tongue I got at that time. I came up saying, "Salatimi. Salatimi." I thought, is that it? You know, I kind of thought maybe there'd be more. So I went around going, "Salatimi, salatimi, salatimi, salatimi." You know, I'm thinking, okay, I'm bringing tongues if that's what it is. And let me go on to the story real quick. I've got to hurry. So I go back to my mom and dad's house. And it's now lunchtime. I was there a long time. I'm drunk. I fill up my plate with everything they got, and I don't touch a thing. Because I'm drunk. I'm just in the spirit. Just Polly said she was drunk this morning coming in. I mean, just, I didn't. My mom didn't know what I'd been drinking. But she was suspect of me. She kept looking at me like, "What have you been doing, boy? I take you out by the woodshed again?" So, cut to the story. By the way, I will tell you, I got to experience a miracle on the way home. We leave about midnight on on Sunday night, the end of the revival, and we were going to drive all the way to San Antonio nonstop. I used to do those things.
Yeah.
I don't do them anymore. But I could then. We are about 50 miles away from Linnaeus, out in the boondocks of Missouri, and all of a sudden the car starts screaming. I mean, people were coming out of houses as we went by because it was such a loud scream from the car. And I'm just saying, okay, God, I'm still feeling the effects of this fresh empowerment of the Holy Spirit. I said, I got to get home, but God just take care of me. So we just kept driving. You know, and pulling into town, I mean, everybody was looking, what in the world is wrong with that car? You could hear us a dozen blocks away. It was like a siren almost. I get home to San Antonio. I go to Slim's Garage the next morning. And they said, how did you get here? And I said, what do you mean? He said, you couldn't drive this car 10 miles in the condition that the universal joint was in. It was completely out. And I said, I don't know why. I just drove all the way from Missouri with it doing that. He said, there is no way. Totally impossible. I said, well, God, I guess I have entered the realm of the impossible. I was just like a Sunday. So, being a music director, I get invited to lead the worship for Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship. Anybody ever been to a Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship? And like this second or third time, they asked me to share my testimony since I had just received the baptism. And I'm sharing it. Well, afterwards, Carolyn says, and she was there because she was my pianist, because we led the worship. She was the only lady there. So she said, you got to quit lying. I said, God's not going to honor you giving a testimony and you're lying. I said, where am I lying? She said, Stan didn't preach on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Had he preached on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, he'd have been tarred and feathered and run out of town. I said, I'll prove to you. So I called Stan up. Stan, that first night of the revival, you preached on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, didn't you? And he said, huh, if I'd have preached on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I'd have been tarred and feathered and run out of town. He said, almost exactly what Carolyn said. And all of a sudden, for the first time, it hit me. No wonder my heart yielded so fast. It was the Holy Spirit Himself teaching me about being baptized with Him. I mean, who gets the opportunity to have the Holy Spirit actually in the teaching? And the reason I really wanted to share that with you, oh, let me finish real quick. One more point. Yeah, it's almost time. So the next meeting with the Full Gospel Businessmen, we had a man, I can't think of his name, I think his last name was Jordan. And afterwards I went up to him, because he had been in this movement of the Holy Spirit for a long time. And I go up and I say, can you help me understand? All I say is subtlety in tongues. I said, am I missing something? He said, well, I don't know. He said, what if in the language of heaven, you're saying, I love you? What if Father just wants you to go around like a child and just say, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you? I said, cool. I can do that. And you know, what if? So all of a sudden, I was just saying, oh God, call us in love, not doing it. All of a sudden, it just broke free. And I've had experiences in tongues in which it changes language on you. Yeah. Determining the situation. And so I'm just saying, it is such a beautiful part of walking with God. It is something that He is willing to chase you all the way to the backside of the boondocks in Linnaeus, Missouri, necessary. To find you, to draw you to Him. The whole point of the this message today is primarily, I'm not even going to preach on praying in tongues, other than it is such a vital part when you're walking with the Holy Spirit. To be able to step out of your intellect and into a realm of heaven's authority, into heaven's language. Okay. Now, I'm not in opposition with one thing the pastor or rabbi says, how important it is to pray in Hebrew, because it is. Hebrew is a very special God language. But even in that, you're still in your intellect. There is a dimension of prayer that takes you even beyond Hebrew. Even though the Hebrew is special, it's deep, it's awesome, there is a place that you step out of the entire realm of the intellect into the realm of the Spirit. So, what I want you to do today, I want to lead you in a prayer. Like I said, we'll finish the news next week.
This is good.